Reverend Joy Douglas Strong and Associate Reverend Alex Worth for offering the space for this event today. And Andy Masters is not here, but he did a lot to help. He's in the office. He isn't allowed to come here. Anyway, particularly Alex and Andy, who did a lot to help set up this event. I'm Peggy Walker, and I am chair of the Lincoln Park Village LGBTQA task force. I'm an ally. I have a trans son, so born female. This panel discussion is the second in a two-part series called Before Stonewall, the LGBTQ Experience in the 50s and 60s. Last week, Tracy Bain, who's right there, publisher and executive editor of Windy City Times, gave a wonderful lecture about the key events and cultural issues impacting the LGBT community before Stonewall, so starting with when there was very little data in the 1800s and coming up to the Stonewall era. Today we're going to hear from four panel members about what it was like to live through the period as one of LGBT person. So the event itself is hosted by Lake View Presbyterian Church, Lincoln Park Village, Howard Brown Health, and Gerber, Hart Library, where Tracy spoke last week. We decided not to introduce each organization, but in the center table in the back, if you're interested, there are materials. So feel free to pick up materials, after the event. There she is. She's going to get a standing ovation here. A few housekeeping items. So there's a bathroom through the kitchen. It's a single bathroom. Alex, are we not supposed to use the sink? Did I hear that? No? Okay. There's water in the back. If anybody wants any of their cups and pitchers of water, just get up and go get some. And finally, after the event, Dave Matteson, who is the second to my left here, and Tracy May will be signing books right in front of the dark red postboard back there. So if you're interested in learning more about LGBT history, go ahead and look at the books afterwards. So the format for the event is each panel member will have up to 7 minutes to tell his or her story about experiencing the 50s and 60s as an LGBT person. And then I'm going to ask them to expand on a few issues that may come up during their presentations, and then open it up for the audience to ask questions. They'll be around after the event to answer any questions you might want to ask them on a one-to-one basis. So, introductions. So, Peggy Walker, moderator, and I've introduced myself already. Bill Gordon, who's gay, man, obviously. Well, not obviously. Village member, Lincoln Park Village member, and retired executive director of the American Library Association. David Matteson, who is bisexual. He's professor emeritus from Governor State University. Marty Smith, who is a lesbian, who is a member of the Center on Halsted Senior Voice, and former allied medical professional. And Gloria Allen, who is trans, who is also a Center on Halsted Senior Voice member, currently working with trans youth at the Center on Halsted, and much fun, whose life was the subject of a play produced by Steppenwolf's Garage Theater in 2012 called Charm. And she is charming. So I think that's it. Who would like to start? Any volunteers, or should I just start with Bill? Bill's going to start. And I'm going to try to remember to keep time.
Good afternoon. My name is Bill Gordon. I'm representing gay males. But I think it needs to be said, white or man, that none of us is distinctly one thing or another. There's a continuum. I've been married, I've had female lovers, I've had male lovers. But on that continuum, I kind of segue from being one thing, then another, and another. But we're not talking about my life specifically, except for that period of time which predates Stonewall. I was born in 1936, I'm 80 years old, and when I look back over those early years, I sometimes can feel my heart begin to pound. I was 4 years old. We were living in a very small farming community in South Central Kansas. A man was invited to stay in our house. He didn't have running water. And he took a bath in one of our round metal tubs. And as a four-year-old, I witnessed that, and I can remember flushing, feeling hot, knowing that my reaction to his nakedness was somehow inappropriate. I didn't really know why. When I was 12 years old, I was in, we had moved by this time to a town of 30,000 people, which in Kansas is a metropolis. And I came home from school in the eighth grade, and the Reader's Digest had arrived in the mail that morning. And if you remember, the Reader's Digest always had the table of contents on the front. And one of the items listed, it said, homosexuality, the scourge of America. Well, I was momentarily frightened. I went back to school, anxious all afternoon so I could get over and read the article. I got home and read the article, which was written by two other were MDs and two other were PhDs in psychology, saying what horrible human beings we were. One of them promoted that we should all be castrated. Another said that we should all have lobotomies before novice. Another said, if you're a parent and your child conveys to you that you're gay, be sure to have them institutionalized. Can you imagine how that felt to my 12-year-old? So I sneaked off to the public library, went to the card catalog. Didn't want anybody to see me, and I went through the card catalog and looked at homosexuality. And do you know what it said? It said, see mental illness in criminal activity. Well, I knew right then I had to hide it for the rest of my life. How could I be whatever they say it was? But the odd thing was, as attracted I was as I was to men, I also had this attraction to certain kinds of women. So confusion continued. By the time I saw that item in the Reader's Digest, I had already had sexual experiences with other boys. Not uncommon. Both gay, straight, whatever you happen to be. Most boys experience it. Pee the farthest, whose penis is the longest, who's got this, who's got that. And I had been through all of that, and I actually had an ongoing sexual relationship with a 16-year-old boy next door, starting when I was 9. And I looked forward to it. But I also had hankered after some sort of relationship with a woman. Well, as the day, years went by, I realized more and more and more it was going to be essential that I hide. Because in 1953, I think, I should have confirmed it, but it was near that time, I was taking a class in civics in high school, and our civics teacher instructed us to read headlines in the newspaper and then write a small article about it and bring it to school. Well, I opened the paper one day, the Hutchinson News Herald, and here was the headline, President Eisenhower signs executive order to fire all the homosexuals. And I thought, there's that word again. And that's what I am. The article was about President Eisenhower signing an executive order that said anyone who was or was suspected of being homosexual was to be fired from the federal government, and 17,000 people were fired in the first 90 days. You didn't have to be gay, you just had to suspect. Well, then I knew federal employment was probably out the window. How could I possibly run the risk of ever getting a job with the government? How could I ever get a job with a public institution that might turn around and decide I was the person to be fired because I had sex with a boy? So I thought, I better have sex with a woman too. So I had sex with a woman. Then I thought, well, I can say I was this, maybe I was that, and how can you accuse me of being either this or that? Well, time marches on. I get my master's degree. I'm on a job. And I know I had better be careful about what I say about myself. Because my career was going to be in public libraries. My goal was to start creating libraries in the rural parts of America that had no public libraries. When I got my master's at the University of Denver in 1962, more than half the country did not have public libraries. So that was my goal. 15 years doing that, and then I wanted to become the director of a public library in one of the large eastern counties and states. And all that worked out. But throughout my career, I worked for boards, community boards, expected, but by God, I was never going to say it out loud. As a matter of fact, this is the first time I've said it out loud to a group of people. I'm 80 years old, and for the first time I've said, I'm a man who's gay, is predominantly gay at least. I'm married, I had a wonderful marriage for 10 years, I had a female lover for 30, still do, as a matter of fact. I had a male lover for 22, and would still have. Not you. I'm sorry, I was so funny. I told you about this because we had this conversation about my conflicted life. And I had a male lover for 22 years who would still have him if he hadn't died 6.5 years ago. He was 20 years younger than I am. What's that all about? You know, my younger brother died young. My lover died young. Who's going to look after me when I get really old? I have finally decided, no matter what I have, I've had a wonderful life. I've had wonderful friends. In spite of the fact I had to gird my loins and protect myself and never say exactly who I was on the, you know, below my active public life, I nevertheless had a wonderful life, but there were sacrifices I made. I did not develop a circle of gay friends for fear of what that meant. I was very close, never went into a gay bar until I was over 60 years old because I was afraid somebody would see me related to my job, and that would be the end, because a board could fire me without cause, and I didn't dare run that risk. I wanted my job, I needed my job, and I thought the only way I could protect myself completely was to not be who I really was. Now it's almost too late, and I'm disabled, I can't run after anybody. Of course, yes, one woman said to me, you know, now that you're on crutches, we like you even better, because we catch you. And so maybe there's some advantage. I'm not sure. But I'm finally comfortable with who I am. The question that may be asked, unless you're going to cut me off, is did I ever tell my family? I was in my 20s when I told my three siblings. I had an older sister, a younger sister, and a much younger brother, and I told them all. I never told my parents. My father died when I was a teenager. But I knew my mother knew. But I knew my mother, even though she knew, and she knew that I knew that she knew. I knew that she didn't want me to know that she knew because we would have to talk about it, and she wouldn't know what to say. And she said wonderful things to me to let me know that she knew after I got a divorce, I remember saying to me, Bill, you're a wonderful son, a wonderful man. I hope you find somebody to love to spend the rest of your life with. I want to let you know, I don't care who it is, as long as you love each other. Do you understand me? I don't care who it is, as long as you love each other. And she met my male lover, she met my female lover. She liked them both. Either one would have been fine. She's gone, long gone too. Somebody said, my father was a hillbilly from Arkansas. And somebody said, what do you think you really would have thought if you told him you were gay? And I thought, you know, my daddy kind of talked about gays, and he called me Billy Bob. And I think he would have said, if I said daddy, because I was still a teenager, and I called him daddy, I'm gay. I think when he would be kind of scoffed, and then he would have said, but Billy, Bob, I don't care what you are, just be careful where you stick your finger.
Yes, it's a great story.
Ongoing, meaning 6 months to a year relationships with three different women, and the third one was and is my wife. We've been married for 56 years now, which is getting rarer and rarer. She's an incredible person. My book, which I hope you'll take a look at, called I Took Both Roads, is dedicated to her because of her incredible generosity and ability to continue to love me, even when the marriage was very different from what she expected it to be. My parents were liberal Protestants and didn't say anything negative about homosexuality, but the church I was going to, a small town Methodist church, did. I'm skipping ahead, if it isn't coherent, you can ask questions later. In my senior year of college, I fell in love with my wife. Because my book has come out, I've used false names for people, and I'm going to use some of those here. So I call my wife Melissa in my memoir of life. we have been honest with each other about everything important in our relationship from the very beginning. She, like myself, is trained in psychology, and in her case, she's a pediatric psychiatric nurse. So we had lots of our schooling on communication, thank goodness. Because when I finally realized that I was bi, then we needed that communication. That occurred because of a strange dream during my last year in the graduate program in psychology and pastoral counseling at Boston U. Many of the professors at Boston U believe that if you're going to do therapy with other people, you want to go through it yourself. So I got into therapy with a psychiatrist who they had recommended. His name was Dr. Jordan, and I can say it because he's dead now. And three or four sessions in, the morning of a session, I woke up, and I woke up my wife and said, Melissa, I had a weird dream last night. You know, I'm supposed to see Dr. Gerber today. I had a dream about her. It was a wet dream. What do you think I should tell him? And Melissa said, well, you certainly should talk about it because it's probably a transference dream. So I girded myself and walked into the therapy session and did a little bit of small talk to kind of warm up. And then I said, I had a dream and I want to share it with you. And he thought, that's fine. It's important to share your dreams in your therapy session. Well, the dream was about you. And then he started backing up his chair and talking to you. And he kept telling me verbally, tell me more, it's okay. Everything I was seeing meant it wasn't okay. The main thing I learned from that is it's safer to tell your wife who loves you than it is to tell your therapist. So I never said, I continued the therapy because of some other peer issues and stuff like that. But I never said anything more about the dream. As I said, my wife and I were honest throughout, and we had an opportunity to go on a sabbatical. And I was doing a lot of research on gender roles and masculinity and how the definition of masculinity in our culture was much too narrow. And I grown up in a family that lived out the traditional gender roles in one respect, but on the other hand, my father was an extremely warm person who let me know he loved me. And so I wasn't afraid of hugging and touch. So I chose Denmark because I felt at that time, 1973, that they were way ahead of us on gender role issues. And also on women's liberation, they didn't call it that. Many, many, many women were you're going to be out in a job and needing other professional people, and certainly some of those will be gay and they'll be more open about it than they would be here in the U.S. And I will be taking care of two, we have two kids at that time, both preschoolers. And I'll meet some people, mostly nursery school teachers and so on. I want you to make a promise. You can investigate the gay world as much as you like, academically and in terms of going out to bars and so on. Just promise me you won't get involved sexually with another man. And of course, it wasn't what I fantasized, but it also made perfect sense to me in terms of her needs. And I respect that she made it clear before we even went, so we could have made other decisions if we wanted to. When we got back, I took a job. I stayed where we were working, where we had been before, in the sense of the college that gave me the sabbatical, which was Marietta College in Ohio, on the West Virginia border, in the most conservative state of all of Ohio. Went for very cold water.
Dave, what year is this?
I'm sorry.
Do you remember what year this is?
Oh, thank you.
More or less.
Moved back from Denmark in 74, but I started in Marietta in 68, right after my college, my doctoral degree. But I was very involved in experiential teaching there, though that school wasn't very much doing much of that. And so I had almost all my sex students involved in the local mental health center. And they asked me to become their clinical director. I agreed to do it. Then they decided they didn't have enough money to hire an administrative director. I should do both. And to make a long story short, it was in the course of 14 months, it was destroying my mental health. And so I decided I had to quit that job. And I went looking at schools I'd looked at before that were experiential learning places. And Governor State University was one of those way back then. And there were lots of things wrong with Governor State, and still are, but it was the right place for me. So when we moved there, I became much more comfortable with my life. But Stonewall didn't change everything. And two different people, one of them, wonderful, caring, straight man named Bill Katz, who was my acting dean, warned me. I came out to several people that I trusted on the faculty, and they warned me, don't let word get around until you're tenured. So here we are in 68, that's not right.
When you came here from there?
I'm sorry.
The 70s?
In this, here we are, yeah, it's in the 70s, it's after 75, and I'm closeted with most of my colleagues until I'm tenured. When we moved to the, well, we're living in Marietta, Ohio, I made my first trip to a gay bar and my first experience with gay sex. It was just before we were going to go to Denmark, so I was very interested in Europe, and these weird coincidences keep happening in lives. I'm sitting at the bar, wondering if I could attract another man and whether what would happen. And a guy sits down beside me, and he's from Austria. And we begin to chat, and he said, you know, I wish we were back in Austria. We have this wonderful custom. If I were talking to you in Austria in a gay bar, there'd be a candlestick here. And if I wanted to go home with you, I would light your candle. And you would know that that meant I was interested.
You're buying a 12-volt candle.
Okay. And And I pretended to light his candle, and we had just an absolutely wonderful evening and night together. So then the next morning, I called Sandy and said, you know, everything's going well at the Gestalt Institute conference. Am I over time?
You're over time.
And, but I have to tell you what happened, and I'm not going to keep it from you. And I told her the story, and she began crying on the phone. And she said, I'm glad you told me, but I wish you'd waited till we were home. Okay. We'll continue with questions later.
Yeah. Okay.
We're still together. I have a regular gay partner who was a seminary friend.
Marty.
Reintroduce myself again. I'm Marty Smith. And I'm sure that if Peggy had told you, you would never guess that I represent the L. I dress specially. I think this is probably what I was wearing in 1969. Although, this isn't the exact same thing, but back in the day, it was definitely a corduroy jacket and blue jeans. These are Gloria Vanderbilt jeans, not the JCPenney Lee jeans that I wore then. It's actually sort of adopted as my lifelong uniform. I've been in blazer and jeans ever since. I'm pretty much comfortable that way. I'm an Illinois farm-bred gal. I'm 71, so I really say that I'm probably too young to be discussing Stonewall, which I'm not, but I thought I'd just say that. I want to introduce myself as a Carcharian lesbian and feminist. And feminist, of course, has become almost a dirty word, so here it used anymore. I think the new terminology is gender equality. Somebody can correct me if that's not right. In terms of, the only time you hear anyone use the word feminist anymore is to say I'm no feminist, but, and then go on to say something actually very feminist. I grew up on a farm. I have lived in Chicago most of my 71 years with the exception of about 5 years that I lived in Madison and Houston and then Chicago. I went to Houston. I have to admit, unlike gentlemen, I have certainly not had very many sexual experiences with men. I don't know how I feel about that. I certainly don't feel badly. I tried a couple times, but you know, it didn't work out well for me at all. And then was reluctant to figure out what was going on with me. Finally occurred to me that maybe I was a lesbian. Then I was afraid to do that because what was going to happen if I weren't? And so eventually I met a guy who had moved to Madison. I was working in a hospital. And his wife had come to Madison to work on an advanced degree. And he was working in the lab. And he just loved all things Houston. And he talked about Houston all the time. And so I thought, oh, gee, maybe I gotta go. I've never lived outside of the Midwest. I'll go to Houston. And a little bit I realized the reason I was going to go to Houston was trying to figure out where my head was and who I was. So off I went, got a job going there. Off I went, ended up having my first relationship there, which lasted about a year and a half. I did not do a good job of picking my first lover, which is another term that I really like that you never hear used anymore. And it's just, I really like the term cover. It just says so much. And it used to be used by both straight people and gay people. And now everybody's a fiancé and no one's ever uses the word lover anymore, but I really like it.
Amen.
And so, anyway, this first woman that I took as a lover, we started living together, and I didn't really think about why she was so easily ready to move in, and it turns out until two or three days before we first met, she in fact had been institutionalized, and it turns out they got around too soon. She was pretty certifiably crazy we had a very strange and scary relationship. It was physically scary and physically abusive. And eventually I escaped it and moved out 2 weeks later, having been led around by my libido. I moved back in again with her. We had a situation, she once attempted to shoot me. I mean, it was just absolutely nuts. I'm 20 years old, I'm in the bars, and I'm absolutely crazy. And so finally, I hightailed it back to the farm to mom and dad. And I was there for a few months, and then I ended up finding a job in Rockford, and ended up being there until like 1973 when I moved back to Chicago to stay. I wanted to give you some dates. The assassination of Martin Luther King. 1968, the assassination of Bobby Kennedy. 1968, the Democratic National Convention here in the chaos. The 1968 Republican National Convention, a couple of weeks before, which had plenty of chaos, it just didn't hold a candle to the Democratic one here. The 1969 in June is Stonewall. Also in 1969, the murder of Fred Hampton and the Black Panthers in their beds by the Sheriff's Department here. Also in July of 1969, United States of America lands a man on the moon. And so, and Stonewall was in 1969 in June. A lot of stuff going on. Stonewall wasn't really noticed very much in the news when it happened. And the reason it wasn't is that it certainly didn't match any one of these. A couple of nights of bottle throwing and rioting on the part of, quote unquote, as the paper called them, witch lesbians and drag queens. In New York didn't really make news, and I was totally unaware of it here or in Rockford or anywhere else at the time. But we mark that now as sort of our jumping off point into the issue of gay rights. And so I was living in Rockford, I started commuting into Chicago in 1972. The Congress passed the Equal Rights Amendment. Immediately after that, I joined the National Organization for Women, which was the first time I could find other lesbians without going to a bar. Back in the day, the bar was our social touchstone. I see some of you nodding your heads there. We didn't have much other opportunities like we do today. And so, through the years, as I moved back in here, and I did my share of partying and drinking, in 1997, I wound up with throat cancer. And was treated, fortunately, at a county hospital where they saved my life. I had stage 3-4 cancer. And they gave me a new protocol from Johns Hopkins University. I was sick as a dog, could barely lift my head off the pillow for 6 months between chemo and radiation. I had no surgery, they just made it go away. However, I was left with a boatload of very expensive side effects. And so then the insurance runs out, and so then you start having to pay for medications, and you're 52 years old, and having to pay for this and pay for that. So you start running up the credit card bill, and the next thing you know, you are in a really big financial trouble. I bring this up not because it's unique, because it is not. And a number of people sitting here who I live with, well, I shouldn't say it that way, they're my neighbors. I'm fortunate enough to live at Town Hall Apartments over here at Addison and Halsted. For those of you who are unfamiliar with it, it's one of, I think, four gay-friendly, LGBT, excuse me, friendly housing for independent independent living, subsidized housing by HUD in the country. And almost most of us there, it's got 80 units. It's connected, it has support from the center in Halsted, and it has 80 units of independent living. And there are people there who are much, have all kinds of stories like mine. People who survived accidents, people who survived illness. There have to be fully 8 or 10 guys who are, at least half a dozen of them, 30-year survivors of AIDS, who lived there and long ago, needless to say, exhausted all of their benefits. People who are juvenile diabetics, several, couple, three of those. People who had catastrophic accidents but weren't able to collect the big buck. And so there are lots of us who are, have fallen through that crack system. And there are lots of us in the country like that. There are people living there who really push the envelope of independent living. And they're doing that because they want to live in quote-unquote a gay atmosphere. We're very fortunate there. There are people living in nursing homes, living in assisted care facilities, and the center in Halsted has had a program of people who go and visit. They've been asked by gay people who are being visited not to send people who look or act gay, not to send people and have them bring gay literature because of their fear of reprisal from either staff or other residents. These are people who have, many of them, lived out of the closet, not just their own wives, they've lived out of their closet for a long time. And now because there are, because of our medical system and our attitude toward things, and they go back and they go into a nursing home or a nursing care facility or assisted living, and they're back in the closet again. I'm very fortunate not to have that. Very fortunate to, well, it's not perfect, I'm working on a lot of things. Very fortunate to live in a place like Town Hall. And I wanted to fill you in a little bit about that and how it works. And also wanted, okay, also wanted to make a, if I can briefly, I want to quote Tracy's, the book she's edited out, Proud Chicago. If you have an interest in the history of our city, the gay history of our city, it's the place to go. Thanks.
Thanks, Marty.
Thank you. My name is Gloria Allen, and I'm a transgender woman. I've been that way for about 40 years. And growing up in Bowling Green, Kentucky, I came from a large family, and I have 9 brothers and 4 sisters, and I'm the only trans person in that group. And I'm here to say transgender women have been thrown under the bus for years. I came out at an early age, and I wasn't afraid to be who I was supposed to be. My family accepted me, and I love that. I never heard a derogatory statement about who I wanted to be in our household. That was a no-no. My mother and father, they loved each and every one of us. And I was the oldest, so I had to raise my brothers and sisters. And I did that with the kindness and the goodness of my heart, because my mother and father tolerated with me and protected me. We moved to Chicago, and we got here, I think, about 1958. And we moved in Hyde Park, and it was nice, but leaving the household to get to school outside of my perimeter with my family, I had to endure a lot of conflict from people who were ignorant to the fact they didn't understand transgender women, and they hated us. Because I started wearing my mother's clothes at a very early age. And my mother, she was a little bit peeved about it, but she didn't say anything about it. Because she knew I was snatching off the tablecloths and making sarongs and stepping in her heels. I loved it. So my mother, I got to be a certain age. I was around 16, and I was auditioning to this transgender woman. And I told my mother that's what I wanted to do and who I wanted to be. And my grandmother and my mother and my aunt told me, they sat down and had a conference with me, and they said, well, we accept you for who you are, but you're going to have a whole lot of issues when you get out there in the world, because people are not going to be kind to you. So I was warned about that, and that toughened me up. I got out, I went to high school, and I only made friends with the girls. The guys didn't like me, and I didn't like them. The girls, I was able to go to their homes and play with them. But I couldn't play with the boys, you know, because the fathers of these boys and the mother thought that I would influence these guys in turning them into gay or transgender, which was absurd. So in high school, I was chased home, bottles, bricks, talked about to no end, and I was scared, I was frightened for myself, but I am a survivor and I'm a fighter. So I fought back, you know, you might dislike me, but I don't dislike you, but don't put your hands on me. So I was basically a transgender girl who was a tomboy, because I could outbox any guy that hit me, and I didn't take any mess from him. And as I got older, in the 60s, getting ready to come out of high school, there was so much going on, peaceful marching, civil rights movement. It was, I mean, a difficult time. And I remember start liking boys at like 16, 17, and 18. But my mother and father told me, you don't let them put their hands on you. And I didn't let them touch me, but I had a crush on two or three guys. And I, that was something, you know, I had that feeling, but I didn't want to bring it out until I finished high school, which I did. And the first bar that I went to, I was 19 years old, because I had come home from college. And I wanted to get out and experience. And the bar was the Parkside Lounge, which was located on 51st and Cottage Grove. This was a bar that everybody that was gay and cross-dressers and transgender, we would meet up at the watering hole, that's what we called it. And we had so much fun, you know, the love was there, we just had a great time knowing each other, and it was a variation of color, you know, nobody was all black or all white, everybody mixed in together at this particular bar. And we were across the street from the Armory, which is a well-known place. And as girls, we would get out and shake and shimmy and jump double dutch. And the soldiers would be over there in their tents out in the bar. And we were just out there having fun and shorts on, and some girls wore high heels. And it was strange, but they did it, and I loved it. And the soldiers, they would sneak over to us and try to talk. And some of us flirted back with them. Then I remember going back as a childhood, things started hitting me all at once. At the age of 7 or 8, or maybe early, I don't remember, but it was an early age, my mother and father both were, and they left us with the babysitter. The babysitter, I remember her name was Miss Evans, and she had a 17-year-old son. And I was young, really young, I believe, because it was only two of us then, me and my brother. And the babysitter's son, 17, he violated me at an early age. And I didn't know what was going on, and I didn't know how to explain this to my parents, because, you know, who would believe somebody small and don't know about sex? And I didn't. And this guy did this to me for a year. And I was devastated by it as I grew up and started remembering all these things. And I hated boys because I thought boys were just the most horrible creatures in the world, because something that I possessed in me, this guy took away from me. And I hated men for that. I hated my father. I hated my brothers, because if they would touch me, I would cringe. And this stayed with me for years. And then as I got older, I started getting out, doing things that I shouldn't have done. Because parents back then, in that age, they didn't teach us about sex. We didn't know anything about sex. So everything that I learned was from the streets, which was wrong, you know. And I think that parents that have children that are different, gay, transsexual, they should sit down and talk with them about the world, because people are not going to like you if you're different. I found that out through my life. Fat, skinny, bald head, a head full of hair. Everybody had an issue about something. And the church, I was raised up in the church. I went to the church every Sunday, a black church on the south side of Chicago. And the churches back then in the 60s and the 50s, even through the 70s, the black churches especially taught hatred among gay people and transsexuals. You know, if I was to wear a dress in the church, they would escort me out the door. And that was horrible, because God said, come as you are. And I was coming as, he said, come as you are. And I just couldn't understand why, growing up, transgender women, we are so hated. Why, I don't know. I don't understand it. Because if a guy wants to put on a dress and look like a woman, that's his privilege. He should be able to do it. But society today, still, people today hate us for no reason at all, you know. And we should stand by, speak up, and talk about it, you know. And I do talk about it. I'm not afraid to come out and tell people who I am. I came out early in life, and I'm the continue to come out and raise a ruckus for my sisters and for my gay family.